a set of two or three key challenges that they faced that they were able to address. Whether it was in an ad hoc manner or a standardized manner, that's an independent issue, and they can articulate that. But basically how they were able to address the challenge that came forward. And then also articulate a set of challenges that they feel they haven't been able to deal with. And at that point, we'd like to open up the floor for discussion to try and get ideas from other organizations about what they think would have been a good way of addressing that particular challenge, whether from their own experience or simply ideas. We'll let Hari and Saurav sort of moderate this aspect of the session. We'll keep time on this end. We could perhaps start with Pratham Books and Mala, if you're open to coming down and starting.
Pratham Books is a children's publishing house, and we publish low-cost books in multiple languages. One of the things about the project is called the Pratham Books Champions Project, and what we wanted to do with this is like figure out how many people, like a community of our volunteers, could read children. So we said we would do an event called One Day, One Story, which would happen in International Literacy Day, and where if you volunteer, we would send you a book, and then you could conduct a storytelling session in your own community with kids that you identify. Most of the sessions are happening with kids who don't have access to books, and this year we had about 2,500 plus volunteers conduct storytelling sessions all across India. So
5,000 sessions.
No,
not 4,000 sessions.
It's a little more than 1,000.
One value is honesty.
And one of our volunteers is also, one of our PB champs is also Dev Kishore, who did a storytelling session last year in Manipur. So yeah, so that's a little about the project. And Mala tell you about the challenges we wanted to address through this project.
The challenge was that we were publishing books, how do we get children to read them? The first step was to ensure that they look at the book, they see that it's an attractive product and therefore want to read it. So this we were able to somewhat address by sending out to these volunteers who are all very invested in the project, in promotion of literacy and reading. So in that respect we were successful. The next step was to see how we could reach more children, and therefore what we did, and actually what Maya really did, was to use our online media, our blog, our Facebook page, Twitter, to get more and more people to join us, register as storytellers, and therefore reach more and more children. So this was another thing that over the years we've been able to sort of address. The biggest challenge was, of course, the cost of books and the dispatch to places like Manipur, which sometimes was difficult. How were we able to reach these people at the right time with the same book? That was the problem, and it still is a bit of a problem because we, as an NGO, we need funds for everything, and that is something that you all know. So these are some of the things that we have sort of solved, but there are many things that we still need to solve, and for that we need your inputs. I look into it to see what else we finished with. You want to add some, and then
no.
Okay, so the other thing was that this work was going on, people were doing storytelling, children were being reached, but we did not have a feedback mechanism which really told us whether the storytelling sessions were good, whether the children were really interested. Because you see, if you ask me, I did a storytelling and I enjoyed myself, so I come back and report, hey, wonderful, it was so good, the kids were all laughing. Whether they were laughing at the story or at me, I don't know. But I'm seeing it in my head, they were all laughing, hey, just like how you are doing right now. And therefore, I report that it was excellent. The photographs caught by people at the session are all showing children smiling, teachers happy, and therefore to assume that it was a good and beneficial thing is a bit foolish, because we know that maybe the kids haven't taken much. So the problem is, how do we ensure that the quality of storytelling is good, that not only is the storytelling good, but that children are reached and the main thing that they want to read, that they want to read in their mother tongue especially, which is again a different level of the problem. So that is another problem. We want them to report back. Many of them do not report back because most NGOs and most people who do these things are either working full time and doing it on a Sunday, or they are not equipped to send back reports which are helpful to for the growth of this project. Got it? Right? So the challenges, the new ideas that we want to hear from you is, one, how do we scale it up so that more children are reached?
Also, how do we, at the moment it's a program that happens
once a year.
So how can it happen throughout the year? How do we make it an easy process that somebody doesn't just do in September, but also all throughout the year? So this is one of the big things we want to address. And and the other thing which at the moment is, like, even though there are 2,500 people, but it's still a small community. You have a personal kind of interaction with them. They are free to give you feedback and things like that. As it opens up, does it distance the community from the organization, and how do you deal with that? Like, how do you make sure that you still have that connect with the community? If you had something where they just self-report, it automatically goes onto a website, you're not even seeing it. So you also will be a little disconnected from the community. So how to ensure that that doesn't happen, I think, is a big thing for us to learn, and we want to know how to do it. So
may I ask a question? Is it that you want to have more storytellers, or you want to have more readers?
We want more readers is the bottom line. That is definitely what we want. We want them to be able to read. We want them to want to read, actually. And we're not even saying you have to read Pratham books. No. We're just saying read. We want that to happen. So how do we do that is the question.
May I make one?
Exactly.
How will we say that a person who wants to read or who reads has some meaning out of it? It makes social and real sense.
You mean
comprehension? No. I work in a school, and today we are deluged with the visual images at every turn. And also, the children are very much engaged with each other, and that makes social sense. Either it's a game, or you're wanting to kind of try and belong to some group, or you're trying to establish that you're better than somebody else. This is the subtext.
Right.
And where does reading and making sense, where does it have meaning? So unless that meaning makes some meaning the child is able to derive from the act of reading, and this is a real issue in all schools, it's not just the program and reading books which are outside the curriculum. What sense does it have, other than fear of the exam and preparation for the exam and end result? What does the social meaning does it have? So that's a question I think is most central to this issue.
Yes. So the idea for storytelling itself came because that addresses what you're saying. So when a group of children are together, when there's one person who's reading from the book, when there's some of the kids who want to look in and, you know, they want to read too, and when the children there, from whatever age group, they see that some people are able to read and they're probably enjoying the story more, and therefore I should be able to read so that I can also enjoy it more. So this grouping of children who can read, who can't read, adults who can read and tell, that sort of a heterogeneous group, I think, makes a child think that reading is significant. The minute he thinks it is significant, I hope they will want to read. And if the books are available, which is the next question, if the books are available for them to read, I think even looking through it, it is not important for them to read every word. It is just important for them to feel it, see it, know that it's something valuable, and that comes through a group.
Why do you want to do it more frequently? I mean, the uniqueness possibly is because it's once a year. Why do you want to do it more frequently? I mean, is that, the concept of replication is you're replicating yourself, right? Why?
Because once a year is too little. See, if once a year we're able to get 2,500 people to do, even at a rough count, you know, just a few children, that's a lot of children reached. And the number of children who need this intervention, that number is in millions in India. There are millions of children who don't have this opportunity. And so unless we do it more often with more people.
So is your solution having more people get involved on that week, or is it to have few people do that again and again all through the week? I mean, if you want to spread and if you want to make it a big splash, are you going to make a big splash by having a large event on a day or a repeated event on a thing? You need to think about it a little bit.
Yeah. There's an answer to that in the sense she, Maya, does a brave job for 1 month or 2 months. She's, when this happens in September.
So you want to keep her engaged for the rest of the
year? Yeah, we want her to. No, we want her to have another person to help her do it, because right now she's almost single-handedly doing this. And, you know, by the end of the year, end of the month, we all have to do this to every single finger, because her fingers just drop off. Because engaging with 2,500 volunteers is not easy.
I think also the other thing is right now it's an online volunteer base, and some of them we've built through our sales network, so we know them. But also, how does this movement go to people who may not have access to internet to even report to us and even know about this program and want to engage with us? So I think just to grow.
To think about it.
So I was wondering, has it been, because you're talking about scaling up, doing it, you know, a number of times in a year, and also you mentioned that operationally it might be a problem sometimes to get the book to a place like Manipur. I was wondering, has it been a conscious decision from your side to not digitize the books? Because in a way, people are anyways registering online. So, you know, they have the books with them, and they might do it more often as well, because, you know, the book is more accessible to them as well. The other thing I was wondering, just from like the monitoring and that sort of perspective, is that do you do some sort of background check of the volunteer as well, the one who's going to the communities and doing this reading? So does he have to come, he or she have to come from a certain profile, or you know, have some skills, so to say, or have some sort of sensitivity? So just expanding a bit on that.
We do offer like digital books also during the campaign. Most of our books are uploaded online, and we say like it would be great if you opt for this, because that we also have limited funds, so we can only send X amount of books, because if you can mean that somebody else gets a book. But most volunteers do not opt for the digital book. They always want the book. And another thing we've seen is most people want English books or Hindi books, so also getting the reach of a book in a regional language is the bigger challenge. But we have other people, like there was somebody who translated the book into Sanskrit, because there was a community of Sanskrit volunteers he knew, and then they took it out into their own communities also. So,
can I have a
yes?
Selco has a solar bus. Maybe if they allow you,
I'll put it in my to-do list. I'll put it in my to-do list, and we want to ensure that you carry the set of up.
And write a story around that.
Okay. How do I get a ride free on the Selco bus? Who's Selco bus in charge? Driver of Selco bus.
Personal teaching, why don't you send a bunch of postcards which can be, you guys can pay for yourself anyway. So the instructor can give it to the students. So after the class is done, they can go home and draw something that they learned.
Good idea, yeah.
And then they send it back, and you can look at that and see how much they understood. And they don't have to really pay for it. Right?
Good idea.
So it's a feedback mechanism.
Sure.
I would like you to focus on the question that she asked, because see, the purpose of this session also is to learn from you that what you have done there.
Right.
One of the things which you said was you seem to be doing pretty well in taking these volunteers. Right. So what are some of the lessons that the rest can learn from you in terms of selecting the volunteers, motivating them? What are some of the things which you think you are doing right? Right. So and we think about, can that be replicated by others who also operate in this volunteer model?
So volunteers, I think you know, the low-hanging fruit is always easiest to pluck and enjoy. So our volunteers, we are very fortunate to have volunteers who have been following us on Facebook or, you know, or they've been following our blog. Many of them are young mothers, or many of them are working in schools. Many of them are in NGOs to do with education and literacy. So they already know us through their work, and because we are engaged with them on that level, we already know them. We assume that that is their background, that their background is in either literacy or early childhood interventions. So in that sense, we are lucky to have them, and therefore we do not do a check on them. We just don't have the manpower or the resources or the expertise to check out a volunteer. If a volunteer says she wants to do this, we are happy for her to do it.
But is there any evaluation that you are doing on a continuous basis? I mean, I'm assuming out of 2,500, some might not be really that great.
No, so most of the people who joined us when we were just 100 strong the first year, most of them have continued, and most of them have not really continued. They come back every year, and many of them want to do it several times a year. Not too many times, but at least they do it another two or three times a year.
Maybe even Dev Kishore can share, like, why he was.
People actually made up stories. Children made up songs, and they sang it. So.
Also, we provide like an activity sheet, but we also tell champions that you don't need to follow it. Like, if just use this as an idea starter, and when you see it, then maybe there are other ideas that will come up. So I think one of the successes of the program is that it has very few rules. You can do it on, like we say, okay, try to do it on International Literacy Day, but in case you can't, like, that's not the focus of this program. We want you to read with kids and have a great session. So if you can't do it, it's fine. You can do it on another day. Do it at a time that is convenient for you. Do it with kids you want to do it with. And if suppose you enjoy the session and want to take it forward with others, do it. So I think the lack of rules in this specific program is what encourages people to participate.
Sure. But the fact that you give people ideas, because somebody who hasn't necessarily worked with young children might not, they'll be able to pull it.
Yeah.
Or it gives them the idea that that's what needs to happen. Molly, you have talked about Room to Read. And I know that they create libraries or whatever. In the States, one of the purposes of libraries for children is that the librarian doesn't have to be someone hired, has storytelling as a regular activity. Does that happen?
Yes, it does.
Okay.
So we work with, in the sense, we partner with many NGOs, including, for instance, Akshara Foundation, which is like a sister organization. And they have, in the past, set up thousands of libraries. And so we do ask them to spread this, and many of their librarians do it, a similar thing.
So from what I understand, I think the challenge that you're already facing is a lack of volunteers, or, I mean, 2,500 is a significant number, but I think the challenge that you're saying is that you want to take 2,500 to, let's say, 5,000 and 7,000, right? And if I were to look at the way you've gotten your volunteers till now, it's been a very organic way of volunteering. I mean, people come in. And I don't know what is the way of replicating that part of it, right? Because I don't know how more organic you can do other than probably use Google Ads or something like that, where people want to click on it and come back to your site. But if I were to look at the other challenge of how would you want a more significant number of people and replicate that process, we face that problem, but that's an opportunity for you, is when we go to speak to corporates, they want to engage their employees versus give us money. That is a great way of you to engage. And that's a very easy way for you to replicate things. So I think Deloitte last week had a, you know, like one full, I mean, 500 employees going into schools across Hyderabad to teach, right? I mean, the problem that Teach for India and even we face is when I was a fellow, volunteers used to come in and we had to engage them for a whole day, and I didn't know what to do with them. Right? But if you can speak to them and tell them that this is a great reading program that they can do with the kids,
And if you can do it with one corporate and show it successfully, it's a very easy model for you to replicate. And that way it's, I mean, you can go from 2,500 to 25,000 because all these guys, I mean, with the CSR bill coming in, the biggest mandate is employee engagement. And I think you will have just the right solution for it.
Okay. And you might get continuation.
Sorry, this is last. please respond and then we can
No. I just wanted to say one thing though. I think, you know, when you try to expand the program, I think what's very key here is having an evaluation system for your volunteers as well as the feedback of how they're doing. Because as you get more and more people, the quality of your program can also get significantly diluted if that process is not in place. So I think, you know, having that process of how you're getting, who are the volunteers who are coming in, doing some kind of a evaluation of that and the feedback, I think will be critical to the success of it, you know, the quality of it being maintained as you get more and more and more.
One thing which has not come up too much is, yes, we agree that there has to be more evaluation. To your question, the sad fact is that almost in most corporate or in most urban areas where the CSR projects are usually working, almost everyone is adept only at English or at best at one other language. And what we need are people to volunteer, to read or to engage in languages other than English and Hindi. It's not that we don't want English and Hindi, but it has to be in other languages if you want to read all children. It's not possible otherwise.
No. So we've done the questions, Rasul. We're going to move to the next. but just probably a very quick comment.
I was just thinking what Sarah mentioned.
No, you really need to. Moderator's privilege. Moderator's privilege.
No prerogative.
No, but just, you really need to spend so much on monitoring and evaluation. The worst that you can do is the kid goes away not interested in reading. But the more numbers you get, the likelihood that you're going to get more success. So
that's,
think about whether you want to really waste too much on monitoring and evaluation on that, especially if you're not spending money on the
work. So right now we're not doing that. As I said, we are fortunate to get people who are already invested in this idea and this
project. But that's fine. Yeah. So we'll go on to the next presentation again.
Thank you all.